And the topic for this evening is focus on Jesus. The book of Isaiah, chapter 37. And the topic for this evening is focus on Jesus. You know, it is so strange that most of the time it does happen that throughout the week, I spend my time in preparing something, and before it can be delivered out, the Holy Spirit sends in something else. My topic for this evening was initially the Potter's Touch, talking about how our life mends and changes when Almighty God touches us. But then as I was in prayers this morning, this is what the Holy Spirit conveyed. And there was a change in the word as well. So rather than preaching on the Potter's Touch, we would be focusing on how to focus on Jesus. And this is the topic for the evening. And the text, as I said, is from Isaiah chapter 37. Isaiah chapter 37, verse 3. Isaiah chapter 37, verse 3. I am reading to you from the New King James Version. And it goes like this. They said to him, this is what Hezekiah says. Today is a day of distress, rebuke and disgrace. They said to him, this is what Hezekiah says, today is a day of distress, rebuke and disgrace. It is as if children have come to the point of birth and there is no strength to deliver them. They said to him, this is what Hezekiah says, today is a day of distress, rebuke and disgrace. It is as if children have come to the point of birth and there is no strength to deliver them. God bless the reading and hearing of his word. Many a times it happens that whenever we do not understand what's happening in our life, we have to just close down our eyes and take a deep breath and seek God that he should help us out through our situations. And this is very similar, which happens in the life of Hezekiah, and is similarly happening in the lives of many of us in the family today, that we are at the very, very stage of our life where a new beginning is about to happen, a blessing is about to be manifested. It's just like a child who's about to be born, but when there is no strength in the mother to deliver, the situation becomes very terrible, very distressed, and things do not tend to work out. So this is what the Holy Spirit wants to speak, preach and teach unto all of us this evening. That we all are at a stage of our life seeking God's presence, seeking God's manifestation, seeking God's acknowledgement, but yet we do not have the strength to move forward because of the disgrace, because of the distress, and because of the rebuking of the spirits around us who are distracting us towards our goal, who are distracting us towards the manifestation of the Almighty God. Let us all bow down our heads in the presence of him. That this evening, as this word focus on Jesus, as this verse should speak to us, should teach us, should make us understand that no matter what comes in our life, we should not be distracted, we should not be deviated, we should not surrender ourselves to the enemy, but rather focus only on Jesus, focus only on him, because he is our light. He is our path, our way to salvation, our truth. And through him, we can enter onto the next stage of our life. Let us all open our minds, our hearts unto him, that the Holy Spirit should fill us up, should speak to us, that we may get acknowledged by the presence of the Almighty. Holy, 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 O Lord. Father gracious, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your love, your affection. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for everything which you do in our lives, O Lord God. We thank you for your acknowledgments, O Father, Lord God. We thank you for every step where you stand by us to take care of us, O Lord. Many a time, O Father, in this time of darkness, when nothing seems to brighten our day, nothing seems to cheer us up, nothing seems to console us, nothing seems to comfort us, O Lord, but we know that even though we do not see your Father, there is something happening in the background. There is something happening in the background because you are working among us and in us, O Lord. Though we do not see it, though we do not feel it, though we do not understand it, O Lord, but it is our faith, O Master. It is our faith, O Lord God, that you shall certainly, certainly, certainly manifest your glory, manifest your blessings, manifest your promises in your life, because your word is so, so, so clear, O Father, like so precisely been said to us, O Lord, that whenever you speak out, whenever you lay forth a foundation, whenever you lay forth your words of promises in our life, O Lord, no matter how difficult the way might be, yet those promises will certainly, certainly come to pass. They will not come back to you without proclaiming for what they had been sent, O Lord. Father gracious, we know, O Lord God, that we are poor in our spirit, O Lord. We lack faith, O Lord. Father, today as we come to thee, O Lord, kneeling down unto thy altar, O Father, raise us up, O Father. Build up our faith, O Father, Lord God, that we should know that this light which is shining bright in our lives, that without this light, there is nothing except for darkness. Without this light, there is nothing in our life. And only through this light, we can go onto the door which thou has opened for us, O Lord. Father, Lord God, raise us up, O Father. Raise us up that we should know that without thee, we are nothing. And only through thee, we can enter into the door which is leading towards prosperity, leading towards thy promises, leading towards thy covenant, leading towards thy blessings, leading towards thyself, O Lord. Father, Lord God, raise our spirits up, O Father. Stir us up, O Master, that we should know how important it is to focus upon thee, and let not distractions deviate us. In the blessed name, in the holy name, in the name which is above all names, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 You know, as we read in Isaiah chapter 37, if you even go on to chapter 36, the story is about King Hezekiah. And we all know that he became the king at the age of 25, and he ruled for 29 years. He ruled for 29 years. And he did what was good in the sight of the Lord. He did what was good in the sight of the Lord at his early stages. And he did things which most of the kings, they failed to do. He was there in Judah, taking care of the people there. And because of him, because of how he was, he did so many reforms. He took out all those high places where the Asherah poles, the the worshipping of the god Baal and the other pagan worships which were going on, he took them all. In fact, he even broke down that bronze serpent which Moses had made, because after a while the children of God, the Israelites, they started praising the bronze serpent. They started laying incense. They started worshiping the bronze serpent. They forgot that why the bronze serpent was there, and rather they took it as God himself. So he broke down the bronze serpent into pieces, and God was very pleased with him. And coming back to our text in Isaiah chapter 37, we see that the king of Assyria, Sennacherib, has laid a siege on Lachish, and there he goes there and he is able to capture Lachish. And Lachish is a big city there, one of the strong fortresses before anybody could enter Judah. And he was able to conquer Lachish. And now I would like you all to visualize that after conquering Lachish, where the Syrian king is sitting down, he has built his base there. And now he sends his people down to Judea to come and meet King Hezekiah. And they come with a threat. So as you see and try to visualize that, they are coming down in their chariots and they come right in front of the gates of Judea before even entering and meeting the king. Because ideally, during those days, the messengers used to come into the courtyard where the king used to sit, and right in front of his officials, his noblemen, they used to come and read out the message what their king has passed on to the other one, to the other king. But here we see that these men of war, these men have walked down, they have come down in their chariots, and they are standing right in front of the doorpost, the threshold of the kingdom, and they have not entered inside, but rather they are raising their voices from there, and they are humiliating Hezekiah. They are humiliating and acknowledging all the people there. In fact, those people whom as Hezekiah had sent, his noblemen, his men in the courtyard, his men in the temple, he sent all of them together to go and know what these messengers have to say, to go and understand what the messengers have come to acknowledge. So as they went there, so instead of speaking in the Assyrian language, because these men, they knew the Assyrian language, but instead of speaking in their local language, they start abusing Hezekiah in the Hebrew language. They start speaking so that everyone who's there could hear. Everyone who's there, even those soldiers who were there on the wall, even they could hear. Those soldiers who were guarding Judea, who were guarding the kingdom, even they could hear. They were screaming and condemning God. They were screaming and blaspheming against Almighty. They were doing things which were wrong in the presence of God. They were demoralizing the spirits of the men there. You see, many a times it happens in our lives. Though we receive the promise of our Almighty God, though we receive His blessings, but certain distractions and deviations make us believe that the enemy has sieged over us, that the enemy has taken over us, that our situations have taken over everything, and the presence of the Almighty is lacking in our life. You see, in this story, before even these messengers could come down to meet and to blasphemize against God, to talk ill and against Hezekiah. After they had conquered, after they took over Lachish, they were enjoying and they were praising their victory over that city. And when Hezekiah came to know about this, he was afraid, he got scared. And then all his courtyards, his friends, his noblemen, his advisors, his ministers, they came and advised him that, "My king, you have done a wrong thing by going against the king of Assyria, by going against Sennacherib. And because you didn't bow down to him, you didn't go by sending the royalty which you were supposed to send to him. This is why he is doing all these things. So you should plead to him, send a letter to him that I am sorry for what I have done. And I request you that please accept my humble apologies and do let me know what I can do to establish the relationship which has been lost because of my mistakes." And the Assyrian king sends him a letter back that, "Okay, I am ready to reestablish the relationship with you. And I want silver and gold from your kingdom." And then Hezekiah took out all the gold. He took out all the silver from the temple of the Lord. And he sent it to the king of Assyria. It was a ton of gold and the rest of the silver. And right after this was being sent, we see that messengers have come down to meet the king. Just imagine the setup that when this has been sent to the king of Assyria, Hezekiah would be thinking that they have come down to lay a message of rebuilding or rekindling of the relationship, or they have come with a message to reestablish the relationship. But things were very different, because what they came and spoke broke down the spirit of the men who heard these Assyrians. So today, the lesson for us this evening is, in our life as well, we encounter many situations in our life as well. We encounter how the enemy, how Satan comes and distracts us, how he sends his spirits to come and demoralize us, how he sends his spirits to take control, that we get distracted and deviated from our blessings, from our goals. We tend to move away from the focus, what God wants us to do. We tend to get away from the expectations which he has laid for us to follow. And we start getting distracted, we start getting worried, we start getting anxious. And in the end, we tend to move away from the goals, from the blessings which are being laid right in front of our lives. So the first one, the first spirit which comes to attack us is the spirit of obstruction. And what does this spirit of obstruction do? The spirit of obstruction, it lays forth obstacles on our path. It lays forth barriers, hurdles. It makes us weak. It discourages, it demoralizes us. This exactly was happening with all those people, those ministers who came to listen to what the messengers had to say from Assyria. And the messengers come and say that, "Look what our king has to say, that you people are nothing in front of us, because we are far greater, far stronger than who you are. We have conquered Lachish, and you are nothing in front of us. And they lay forth barriers. They lay forth obstacles. They lay forth things because the king sent a royalty. He sent all the gold. He sent all the silver. But after taking everything in return, they come and they started demoralizing. They started discouraging. They started making them weak. They started making them believe that you are nothing. You are nothing. This is exactly, my family, what happens. These are the voices which we hear. These are the situations which come in our life when we start walking in the light of the Lord, when we start walking towards His ways, when we start walking towards His blessings, towards His directions, when we surrender our lives to Him and we say, yes, oh God, today I surrender my life to you and I want to walk in your ways because your ways will lead me towards salvation. Your ways will lead me towards the blessings which you have laid forth to me. Your word, your way will lead me towards prosperity. Your way will lead me towards thy presence, O Lord. But as we take the first step, Satan with all his troops will stand right in front of you to distract you, to devour you, to attack you. 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 8 says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. My family, my friends, we can be that someone who Satan, who the evil one is prowling around. Wo charo taraf ghoom raha hai hamare. He's just watching and prowling around. You know, when you watch any of the documentaries on Nat Geo or on Discovery and just look into the way how the lion attacks, he just waits patiently. He waits patiently with all his strength. He just waits down. And one mistake you do, one mistake the prey does, and immediately he pounces, attacks, and takes the prey for his lunch or dinner. That is why here the word of God says that be alert at all times. Open your mind, open your heart. Look around with your eyes that you have to be alert, but be at the same time of sober mind. Of sober mind. Do not get anxious. Do not get anxious. Do not be worried. Do not worry about the hurdles. Do not worry about the obstacles. Do not worry about the barriers. When those Assyrians were screaming and insulting right in front of the ministers, they were talking all things which were demoralizing them, which were pulling them down. They were shaking their spirits, including even those ones, those soldiers who were there on the wall, who were guarding. They must have definitely get shaken up that, what are we? What are we in front of such a big army? The army who has conquered Lachish, the biggest fortress. Because it is not easier to come inside Judea, not to come inside Judah, because Lachish was very, very strong. And the king used to fortify. When you say fortify, matlab wo itna zyada usko strong rakhte the that it was very difficult for the enemies to come inside. But now Lachish itself is destroyed. Today, we all are at a stage where what we were depending on has been destroyed. What we were thinking of has been destroyed. What we were assuming that this is our fortress, that this is our strength, that this is the stepping stone through which we can get onto the other side. And this is the way through which we are safe and secure. But today, all that is broken. The walls have come down and then the enemy has entered inside. Satan has come down into your lives and he is prowling around like a lion to feed on you, to feed on your blessings, to feed and take away the manifestations which God wants to be in your life, to take away your mind and to distract you by bringing in obstacles, by demoralizing you, by deviating you, by taking you down, by lowering down your spirits, by putting his feet on your neck, that you may be suffocated with what he is performing in your life. Many of us are waiting down for miracles to happen. Many of us are waiting down for blessings to happen, for jobs to be given to us, for manifestation of businesses to happen, for journeys, for movement, for a new life, for restoration, for health, for mental issues, breakdowns we have in our life, to remove those barriers, the chains which are holding on. All those we are looking upon, but we are demoralized today. We are broken down today because the spirit of obstruction, the spirit of obstruction, the spirit of barriers, the spirit of obstacles, the all these hurdles which we are facing in our life, because things are not working down. Every day you get from your bed and you get out from your bed, you praise God, you glorify God, you have an hope, you have an expectation, you look into your Bible and you start reading that today will be a day where all my problems will be ended. Today is the day where all my troubles will be ended. Today I will get a call from the employer who I've been seeking for a while. Today certain things will happen in my life. I will get new business opportunities. Today I would get, my wait time is over. Today I would get the blessings which I've been seeking since so many months, because I am under tremendous humiliations. People are all around me. They are talking ill. They are talking things which are pulling me down. God, where are you? Why are you not hearing to my cry? The Satan is prowling around me, and he will any way, any time, he might come and pounce on me and put me down. Many of us have this cry every day when we get out of our beds. The second we see is the second spirit which we see is the spirit of deceive. The spirit of deceive. When you read Revelations chapter 12, verse 9, it says, "And the great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him." Satan is a serpent of deceive. Satan is the spirit of deceive. Satan is the one who deceives us in making us believe that this blessing which God has laid in our life is a lie. He makes us believe that the actions which we have taken are wrong. He makes us believe that we are not walking in the light, but we are walking in darkness. He makes us believe in blasphemy. He makes us believe in profanity. He makes us believe that there is no God. Similarly happened in the life of those ministers, those people who were standing there when these people came down from Assyria, and they said, "What God are you talking about? What God are you talking about? Because your king Hezekiah himself has taken down all the altars of your God from those high places, and he has brought all those altars into Judea, that you should all worship your God only in Judea and not in those high places." If you read the text very carefully, Hezekiah did not bring the altar of the Almighty God. Rather, he brought down the altar of those pagans. He brought down the altar of Asherah poles. He brought down the altars of the Baal worshippers. He brought down those altars which were idols right in front of the presence of the Almighty God. But here you see, when Satan tries to prowl around, he makes us to deceive. He makes us believe that even the right is wrong. He makes us believe that even the right is wrong. He makes us deceive things. He makes us look at things. He makes us believe that what we are seeing is what is happening, and God is not around. God is not around. This is exactly what these Assyrians were making them believe. This was exactly what the Assyrians were making them believe. They were making them understand that you should know that this is what is happening, that your king himself is unable to do anything. Your king himself is unable to do anything because he himself has pulled down those altars which were there at the high places, the altars of your God, whom you were praising. He has pulled down all of them, and he has brought all of them right to the place where he wants you to worship. So look at your king, how he is. They were condemning the king. They were pulling him down. They were talking ill against the king. They were making all the Jewish people, they were making the people there believe that God himself is not with them. God himself is not with them. They even went ahead to blasphemize by saying that your God himself has sent us that we should conquer you, that we should defeat you, that we should be your king, that we should come over you, that you should be under us. This is what Satan does. This is what Satan does. This is what the evil one does. He comes to deceive us with his lies. He comes us to look at situations that, see, this is not happening because this is not the way you have to go. The way which you are walking upon is not the right way. He will make us to deceive. He will make us to believe that, my friend, Satan will not come and say that I am Satan. I am the evil one. No. He will come as your friend. He will come in the sheep's clothing. He will come as if he's your friend, and he will come and deviate. He will come and say, you know, the path which you have taken is wrong, is the wrong path. Jesus does not want you to go on this path. Take the path which is better, because that path will lead you towards a promise which God has given to you. That path will lead you towards the manifestation which God wants you to walk upon. He will come and deceive you, like that prophet who came and deceived another prophet, that the angel has sent me that you should come and eat in my house. And when that prophet comes down to eat, the Spirit of the Lord enters and says that you have wronged against me. You have taken measures. You have done things which I didn't want you to do. And now you have to face the consequences. And as soon as he walks away from that prophet's house, the lion comes and attacks. Satan comes and attacks. And Satan kills him. This is exactly what Peter is talking about. That if you allow Satan to enter, even if one small window, if you let it open in your life, Satan will come through it, because he is prowling around like a hungry lion to devour upon your spirit, to take you down and to conquer you. Because Satan will come and deceive you. The evil one will come and deceive you. The enemy will come and deceive you and make you believe. Aapko wo realize karayega ki bhaiya jo aap kar rahe ho, it is wrong. What you are doing is completely wrong. This is a lie, because this is not what Jesus wants you to do. This is not what God wants you to do. You have done things wrong, because look at the way he has sent me to you, because God wants me to come upon you to be conquered. Like how the Assyrians say that we have come to conquer you because your high places have broken down. Your shrines have broken down. Your king himself has condemned you all. And they started blaming the king. This is what Satan will come and make you believe, that you are wrong. that you are in a world of lie, that you are in a place where what you are seeking at, what you are believing at, what you are looking forward is all a lie. And he will come and deviate you. He will come and distract you. He will bring your morals down. He will bring you and he will take you down to the deepest, darkest valley, and he will leave you there in the darkness, and he will make you believe that where you are standing is all dark and there is no light, because you have taken the wrong way. You have taken the wrong path. You are not going and walking in the light which God wants you to do. And the third spirit is the spirit of temptation, the spirit of lure, the spirit of temptation, where Satan comes and tempt you. When you read Matthew chapter 4 verses 9 and 10, it says, "And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Remember, the first thing he will come and do is he will completely demoralize you. He will bring obstacles in your pathway. Obstacles which will not make any sense to you. Unintentional delays. Delays which you will not understand. Somebody might call you from the office and say, "We have scheduled a meeting for you. An interview is there for you that tomorrow by this time you have to attend the interview because it is a very important call. You will be having an interview with the VP. This is a very important interview, and thereafter you will have an interview with the HR. So you can imagine that this interview stands a lot of importance. All of a sudden, the very next day, there is a light off. Your brain starts to worry around that there is a light off. What should I do? You go start to spark the generator. There is no generator in some of the houses, but some who can afford it, they try to spark the generator, but the generator is not sparking. Sometimes there is no fuel, or the generator itself all of a sudden has spoiled. Some problem that the network is unable to establish, because now there is a new Zoom meeting which is there, because you can't go down to his office and meet the VP. There is a Zoom meeting which has been scheduled, but the network has come down and you are unable to go. So Satan brings in so many barriers, so many distractions, so many unwanted, unseen, unaccepted, unthinkable barriers and distractions that you tend to get anxious. You tend to believe that what in this world is happening? What in the world is happening? Why everything has to happen today? Why am I not able to move towards? Your energy levels will go down. He will bring in so much of stress. The spirit of obstruction will come and deviate you so much, so much, so much that you will not understand. But still, if you try to pull up your spirit, if you still try to focus upon Jesus, then the second spirit he will send to you is to demoralize you, is to talk blasphemy against Jesus, is to come and make you believe, come and make you deceive that this interview will not work out, brother. This interview will not work out because though you have joined in late, but the VP is busy in some other meeting, this interview will not work out. Because eventually what will happen after you have joined the Zoom meeting, you will be waiting for the VP to come because the VP is in some other meeting, and you will think, "Thank God, though I got late because of all the distractions and the obstacles, but yet the VP himself has not come down to the interview and I still have a chance." And when this thing goes on, Satan will come and deceive you, you know, because you were late, because of all the obstacles, because of all your lateness, now the VP is attending someone else. He must be taking someone else. You have lost your position. You have lost your interview. He must be definitely interviewing someone else. This man who called you yesterday, he is not speaking the right words. Definitely something else is going on at the background. You will not know. You will not know that VP, who the person he is interviewing, that VP likes that person or the VP does not like you. That is why he is not attending to you. That VP is not a good person. And that is how the spirit will come and deceive you, will demoralize you, will talk blasphemy against God, talk profanity against God. And he will say that your God has left you, has forsaken you. Today when you woke up, your God has not sent the angels to protect you. Today you did not pray to God. That is why he has left you. You did not open your Bible. That is why God has left you. There is no establishment of connection. His presence is not there in your life. Today you did not thank God for who God is. That is why he says, today you did not thank me. I will not allow your interview to go on well. I'm very, very practical for you, to you all, to make you understand this exactly is what goes on in the mind. This is exactly what goes on in our minds. That Satan will bring in so many thoughts. Satan will bring in so much of deceive and distraction that he will make you believe that your troubles are not troubles by Satan, but your troubles are being sent by God. God is not allowing these blessings to happen in your life. God is not allowing you to move forward. He wants to crush you down completely. He wants to demoralize you completely. He wants you to be so down to the very bottom of the earth that you should plead and cry and beg to God. You should be begging to him that God, please give me the blessing. God, please give me the blessing. God, please give me the blessing. Because Satan will make you believe. Satan will make you believe that God wants you to beg. God wants you to cry to him. He wants you to beg to him like a beggar that I want my blessings. God, please, 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 please. I am a beggar. I am begging to you. He does not say that you have to humble. There is a lot of difference between being humble and begging like a beggar. The word of God does not say that you have to be a beggar. God does not intend in any of the scriptures that we should be a beggar to beg him. But he says that you are no more my servants because you are my children. You are mine. I have called you by your name. I have created you in my own likeness. My spirit is in you. When his spirit is in us, then how can we be a beggar to beg God for the blessings which he has foretold in our lives? I was speaking to Sumit the other day, and he shared something very, very, very heart touching to me. He says, the table is laid and there is hot food on the table. But yet your hands are tied. Your mouth is watering. You are hungry. But yet your hands are tied and you cannot eat the food. The time is passing by. The food is getting cold. And he was just sharing with me that as much time goes by, it comes to a point where your hunger will no more be there. You will no more be hungry. And moreover, the food will be cold, which you will not enjoy because your hands are tied. Though you had an appetite to eat the food then, but now it is too late. This is exactly what Satan does before the blessings come to manifest in your life. This is exactly what Satan does and comes to deceive you, that the food which God has laid right in front of you, unless you beg him, unless you come down to the floor, unless you plead him, unless you come down to the very rock bottom of your life, he will not give it to you. And if he gives it to you as well, your appetite will die because that food will not do any good to you. Because it is cold, all the nourishment of the food will no more be there. This is how exactly Satan will come and deceive you. This is how exactly Satan will come and pull you down. This is how exactly he will come and say that, be practical. Be practical. What you say that God is there and I pray to him, this is all spiritual things. These are all spiritual things in the spiritual world. But you are in the world where things are practical, my son. Be practical. What is the use of the food when it becomes cold? It will not nourish your body. What is the use of the food when your appetite will cease? You will not eat it because you no more require that blessing. You no more require that food. This is how he will come and deceive you. This is how he will come and deceive you. And the third spirit is the spirit of temptation. Now when Satan sees that he has sent obstacles, but still you are progressing. He comes to deceive you, but still you are progressing because you have a faith in you, that faith which God is there. Because God will not leave you, my children, my family. God will not leave you. God is still working. He's just giving you a time for you to know that when I have laid forth a foundation in your life, when I have given a promise to you, how do you walk with that promise? He is still around you, just watching to you, because you are now sitting down in the examination hall. A paper has been given to you and the teacher is just looking down to you that how are you answering your questions. He will not come and leak the paper to you, but rather he will come and just watch at you, look into your eyes and see how are you faring in the examination. And the third thing which Satan will come and do is he will come to make you visualize things like the Assyrians did to those people who were hearing them. They came and they started visualizing things. They came and said to them, my people, look at our king. He's so powerful. Look at our king. He's so magnificent. If you surrender to him, if you bow down to him, he will give you peace. He will give you prosperity. You can drink from your own systems. You can drink and eat food. You can be merry. You can enjoy food. You can live with your freedom because he will give freedom to you. You can enjoy your life. Though you have to do is just bowing down to him. Just surrender to him. Bow down to him. Bow down to him. Bow down to the Assyrian king Sennacherib. And he will take care of you. He will take care of all your needs. He will provide you with riches. He will provide you with food. 2,000 horses he will give to you. But all you have to have are men who can ride them. And at the right time, he will come and take you to the land, which is a land of milk and honey, a land which is flowing with all the riches. You will not have a problem. You will not have any issues because you will enjoy life there. Olive trees are there. You will make olive oil. You will eat food. You will enjoy a full three-course meal. You will eat your breakfast. You will eat your lunch. You will eat your dinner. Don't have to worry. You will have plenty of work, plenty of money. Everything will be good. All you have to do is surrender. Today, what are you and I, my family? When Satan even came down to Jesus and said, all you have to do is worship me and I will give you this world. All the riches of the world, all the best of the best, all the things you can imagine of Jesus, the best of the cars, the best of the buildings, the best and the best and the best, all the bank's money, all the money in the world will come down to your feet. All you have to do is worship me, surrender to me, bow down to me. But Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. You shall worship the Lord your God, and only him you shall serve. Many of us, when such an encounter comes in our life, we tend to believe in Satan. We tend to believe in the evil one. We tend to accept what Satan is showing to us. And we believe that, yes, it is so true. Because this man is saying, you can look at how this man is so strong. how this man is so much strong. He has so much of wealth. He has so much of power. He has so much in his bank balance. He has so much of deposits. He has so much. And if I follow him, my life is set. If I follow him, my life is all set. Why do I have to worry about the promises of God? Because so far I have not seen any progressiveness. So far I don't see any light. I am still in the same situation where I started. I still hold a penny when I started this journey of believing Jesus. And even walking after so many months, even that penny has become a quarter now. And after a few days, I do not know what to eat, where to sleep, because everything will be lost. Every blessed day, I am humiliated by those people who call me, who knock me down on my doorstep, who come and demoralize me, who come and pull me down, who come and take me away from my peace. And today, this man who has called me, who has come in my life, it is in fact a blessing of God that though plan A is not working, God says, I'm giving plan B, and he has sent this man who is the plan B of God, and he is a messenger of God, and he will take care of me. But nowhere in the Bible does it say that if God is giving a plan to you, if God is giving a blessing to you, if God is establishing a covenant with you, if God is saying that these are the words which I have spoken from my mouth, these words will get deviated through some other blessing, because what I have spoken to you is not working in your life because of the situations you are in. So I am deviating my words, my blessing, through some other way. No. Nowhere does God say this to you. This is the devil who will come and deceive you. This is the devil who will first send obstacles in your life. He will then come and deceive you. And then the third thing, he will come and make you visualize. He will come and say that I am the promise. I am the one. I have come to change your course of plan. I have come to change the promise of God, because God himself is saying that because plan A is not working in your life, move down to plan B. And then he will say that when you take plan B, there will be rewards. There will be consolations. There will be things. They will come and lure you. They will come and tempt you. They will come and believe you. This is what exactly Satan is doing in all our lives. I am very, very, very true to you, because this is what the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit, is conveying to each and every one in your life, that when you look right into your life, when you look right into your life, be it your job, be it your health, be it your spirituality, be it anything, your business, your progressiveness, your way of walking in the path of the Almighty God, be it any situation of your life. When God has laid a plan for you, his word says, the plans which I have laid for you are the plans to prosper. The plans to prosper and not to harm you, not to deviate you, not to give you plan B or plan C or plan D, or to send some XYZ in your life and come and say to you, I am the messenger of God, and visualize, I will take you to the land of milk and honey. I will give you the olive oil. I will give you food three times. I will give you the riches of this world. And when you see that, yes, this man is a powerful man. This man has so much of power, so much of wealth, so much of assets, so much of things that even the politicians, even the ministers, even the rich man of the world are bowing down to him, then why not I? Why not I? Why not I bow down to him? Because he is the plan B of God Jesus. He is the plan B of our Lord Jesus. He is the plan B of our Lord Jesus. Today I tell you, most of us are in the same structure of life. Most of us are at the very same phase of our life where Satan is coming to send hurdles to us. He is coming with boulders, big, massive boulders attacking our mind, our heart, our thoughts, our life. Every blessed day, he comes and attacks us. He comes and deceives us. He comes us to make us believe that you have to follow plan B, because God has said plan A is not working in your life. Now, what exactly does God have to say? What exactly does the Holy Spirit want to say to us this evening? What exactly God wants us to do when we face such situations, such troubles, such ailments? I would say ailments, because these things will pull you down rather than push you up. These things will not build you up, but rather break you down. So what do we have to do in this time? The takeaway for us this evening is to be still and calm. Psalm 46:10 says, to be still and calm and know that I am God. To be still and to be calm and know that I am God. When those Assyrians finished speaking, screaming, condemning, demoralizing, and at the end giving a false promise that we will take care of you, they were overshadowing their bondage. Because end of the day, when they said that we will take you to a land flowing with better things, it was what? It was bondage. It was bondage to the evil one. But they had put up in a way to make the people believe that you will be profitable. You will be profitable when you surrender, when you bow down to our king. But what do we see in Isaiah chapter 36, verse 24? It says, those who were hearing this, those who were listening to what these people were screaming, they said, but they kept silent. They did not say anything. For the king's command was, do not answer them. But the king's command was to be calm and to be still. Do not answer them. Do not answer them. When obstacles come in your life, when Satan comes to deceive you, when he comes to make you visualize and give you new offers and offers of plan B, C, D, and so on. Do not talk to him. Do not even rebuke him. Just be still. Be still. Be quiet. Be still. Be quiet. But I do not say that to do not do anything. Here, if you see what Hezekiah did, when they came back to Hezekiah, they reported everything to him. And Hezekiah tore his clothes. He wore the sackcloth. And then the first thing which he did, he entered into the temple. He went to the church. He entered into the presence of God. He went to his quiet place. And then he sent those people to the man of God, to Isaiah, to seek what God wants to say. And they sent, and he sent the others, the ministers, to Isaiah to seek what God wants to say. Today, my family, I want to encourage all of you to make you understand and believe in yourself that Satan, though he has laid obstacles, though he has come to deceive, though he is offering you plan B, C, D, and thereon, but you be still, be quiet, do not say anything to him. But rather, when Hezekiah tore his clothes, in the spiritual senses, it meant that he gave away what he was in. That means that he gave away his kingship. He gave away that authority of a king, but he humbled himself by wearing a sackcloth. And then he entered into the presence of God. This is exactly what God wants us to do today. Wearing sackcloth means to humble yourself. Wearing sackcloth means to pray and fast. Wearing sackcloth means self-denials. Wearing sackcloth means to come and only come in the presence of Almighty God. Today, Satan might visualize so many things in your life. He might send so many things by making you believe that the food which is laid on your table will not do any good to you when it becomes cold or when your appetite is lost. He will make you believe all these things. And he will also make you offer so many other things. Make you offer so many other things that when plan A is not working, stick on to plan B. But I encourage you all, rather than me, the Holy Spirit is encouraging you all. The Ruach Kodesh is encouraging you all to believe that when you are in such a situation, wear your sackcloth. That is, come in humbleness. Be humbled. Come in humbleness to the presence of God. Come praying to him. Come seeking his face. Come knocking on his door. He does not say that beg him. It does not say plead him. It does not say that come like beggars in the presence of God, but rather as the children of God, like the sons and daughters in his kingdom, like the authority which he has given to us, because we are not beggars, but we are his children. He has created us in his own likeness, in his own image. We are no people who are like those worms in the earth, but we are far, far better than rest of the creation, because that is what even Jesus says, that we are far, far better than even the rest of the creation which God has created. And go in the presence of the Almighty God. Be still, be calm. Be still, be calm, and know that there is no plan B, plan C, plan D, but whatever God has said will surely come to pass. Because he says, the plans which I have laid for you, the plans which I have given to you are for your own betterment. The plans will progress. The plans will progress because my words which I have spoken out from my mouth will not just come around and hover around and come back to me or come and say to you that plan A is not working, so stick on to plan B. This is not what will happen. And as we see in the life of Hezekiah, when we read, when they went down and seeked Isaiah said to the ministers that this is what the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies, the Lord of the living world, the Lord of your own spirit says to you. Do not be afraid because of the words you have heard or seen. Do not be afraid of the words which you have heard or seen. The Holy Spirit is encouraging each and every one of you, be it your interviews, the hurdles in your interviews, the hurdles in your businesses, the hurdles in your health, the obstacles and the situations in your life, those other things, those plans which the other persons or the other spirits are bringing, that plan B, C, D are there so that you can come and take and grasp those plans. But God is saying that be still, be quiet, and do not be afraid. Be calm. Humble yourself in the presence of Lord. Do not beg, because we are the children of his. We are his kingdom children. He has created. Do not beg, because he has laid forth promises. But be humbled. Come in his presence, praying to him. And he will send you a spirit to encourage you to walk on the promises which God has laid right in your life. May this word bless you. May this word teach you. May this word preach to you and make you understand that the Almighty God is bigger and better than anything else in this world. Amen, amen, and amen to you.